Hello and welcome everyone. Glad to be taking part in this event. My name is Stefan Walrave and I'm co-founder and CEO of Imanta. Imanta is a European software company specialized in end-to-end service orchestration. And today I will be talking about end-to-end automation for 5G. Although a lot of attention goes to things like Open RAN, end-to-end automation is really critical for mobile operators to monetize 5G. 5G and automation are really interconnected. And the reason why we talk about cloud native architectures, microservices, open APIs, etc., it's all about enabling automation. Of course, it's easy to say we need end-to-end automation, but it's not straightforward to achieve in any telecom context, but definitely not in 5G. There are quite some challenges. First of all, there is a complexity of the 5G use cases like network slicing, private 5G networks, low latency edge applications, etc. In addition, there is a need for a lot of flexibility and dynamics for these use cases. And finally, we have the scalability challenge where we want to be able to deliver these 5G services in a scalable way to make it a viable business. So let's go into these challenges in more detail. First of all, I think the complexity challenge is quite clear. And we have, for example, a network slice, and you see it crosses multiple domains and multiple layers. And within each domain and layer, also have different vendors, providers, and multiple technologies. So this really makes it a challenge to automate this. But if you have to do this manually, it would take even it would be really undoable almost. The flexibility challenge consists of two parts. First of all, we have about the dynamic deployment of these applications. It could be an application has to be deployed in a private network, in the on-premise network of the enterprise, or it should be in the edge, in the core, or even public cloud. So it all depends on the type of application. For example, a control function should be, for example, in the core, while low latency application should be in the edge or in an on-premise deployment. There could be customer specific SLAs or other requirements, like it's not allowed to be deployed in the public cloud. So it's all depending on the context, and this context can change. So it doesn't mean that once an application deployed in one location, it always has to remain there. So it has to change, and this should happen, of course, in a seamless way. And then the second part is that these services themselves are also changing continuously. It's not that you deploy a service once and then we keep on using it forever. No, there will be continuous updates to applications, the underlying infrastructure changes, or new devices are connected to the network. There are new requirements that have to be satisfied, etc. So you really need automation in order to provide this flexibility. And then finally, we have the scalability challenge. This is about being able to monetize this 5G services. There it's important that you can deliver at scale. You build it once and deploy it many times. That's a typical approach. And so we standardize for a mass market. However, I already talked about these flexibility requirements. It's clear that in the 5G use cases require a lot of customization. So different types of SLA for network slicing. You have private 5G network can deploy it in many different ways. Maybe a part in the enterprise network or part in the public cloud, in the edge, in the core, but can also be that an enterprise doesn't have their on-premise network, or it cannot be used, or public cloud is not allowed, etc. So there's a lot of customization needs, so the standardization for mass market is not going to work, but we can also not do this one by one, because that will take too much time and cost way too much resources. So we have to find a way to efficiently get to mass customization, creating, delivering, managing many service variations, and this also in the long term. So end-to-end automation has to cover these challenges, but there are also many pitfalls along this road towards end-to-end automation. So it's really important to focus and not deviate from the path, because that could end up in a disaster, because once you start automating, it can go really quick and things can go so wrong very quickly. So a way to handle this is by using a telco service factory concept. So a telco service factory consists of two dimensions of automation. The first one is the well-known way of automation, where we try to deliver services as fast as possible. We increase delivery speed and decrease the cost. And this can be done with a service orchestrator. And then the second dimension is actually about the speed that you can deliver new variations or updates to the market. So it's really about the innovation speed. How quickly can you deliver innovation to the market and probably also for a lower cost than currently? So there it's about supply chain automation. How can you increase this innovation speed and lower innovation cost? The service orchestration, it's about tackling the complexity challenge. And the way to do that is using a top-down approach, where you focus on the end-to-end service. What is the value we want to bring to our customers? And so this always starts also from a limited number of business parameters you want to be able to change. And then we start refining in a stepwise way towards which domains are relevant, which part of a domain is relevant, which infrastructure, et cetera. And along this path, of refinement, you can create abstraction layers, and they will support that you can make future changes with a minimal or no impact at the service level. And for example, you want to be able to change vendors, or you want to do vendor equipment upgrades or software upgrades, or you want to have be able to select between different domain services to provide the same kind of functionality. It's all things that will have to be hidden from the end-to-end service, because that's in the end not relevant for the end customer. They just care about the service and how it's delivered. It's not important to them. And so that way you can make abstraction of this complexity and make it more simple to manage it. And then of course you use an iterative approach. So you once you have automated your end-to-end service, you can then start building new service variations, add them to your service, or you create automate additional services. So the opposite way is a bottom-up approach, which is used typically is more like automating and optimizing domain per domain, but then you're not working towards a specific end-to-end service, so the scope remains quite broad. So it's difficult to simplify things and to handle the complexity. Yeah? You still have to expose things because maybe you could use it in the future. So you spend a lot of time on optimizing and the whole domain, but without actually much value to the customer yet. A second value of the service orchestration is providing the dynamics we need and that we mentioned before. And for this, we see an intent-based orchestrator as the best solution. With intent-based, we mean that you can go from, actually you can compare it with a navigation system. So there, wherever you are, you can indicate, I want to go to this location at the destination, and the navigation system will find a path towards that. If you deviate from that path, it will adapt and find another route or if there are traffic jams, roadblocks, will adapt and find a path so that you in the end you get to your destination. The same way an intent-based orchestrator works. So you indicate what the desired state, the intent is, and then in whatever state your system is or your network, it will get to that state. And if in the meantime a failure happens or the network changes because someone else is making change or another system, it will adapt and be able to still get you to the desired state. And this can include scaling, self-healing, etc. So it's not only about provisioning a service, it's really about covering the full life cycle. And so an intent-based orchestrator will bring a lot of flexibility and also resilience. This kind of dynamics cannot be delivered using a conventional workflow-based orchestrator, because these are, we talk about static services and service definitions where you can define how to go from point A to point B following a really a fixed set, a sequence of steps. So if you're not in point A, you cannot use this workflow to get to point B. You first need another workflow maybe to get to point A. But then you have to know in which location you are now, which typically, or which state in the case of the network. And typically you don't know the exact full state of your network. And you also have to follow this predefined sequence. So if something happens during executing this workflow, you're stuck because you can only follow this specific set steps. So it's really about automating the existing human process and not providing all this dynamics and flexibility of how things could happen or could change. Then the supply chain automation is really focusing on bringing new variations, new updates to the market as fast as possible. But of course, we want to keep the same quality as before. And it's not because you start sending, bring variations much faster to the market that the quality can be lower. No, not at all. So therefore we need continuous brutal testing of services and all their variations. So it's not only a few tests, no, it's really everything has to be covered. And that's why you of course need automation there, because otherwise this is not doable. You use a CI/CD pipeline for this that will create a repeatable process, and every change, whether it's in the network or a new vendor, you want to change the service definition or you create new service variations, everything goes through this pipeline and will be automatically tested. And that way you get feedback rather quickly. It's a way to fail fast. And to find out what are the issues and how can, and then to resolve them and then send it to the pipeline again. And once it goes fully through the pipeline, you know, okay, it's safe. We can deploy this in production, and doesn't mean you immediately have to do this in automated way, but that's something we can work towards. And then you can really speed up the innovation speed. The second part that in the supply chain that is important is being able to manage this variability, this flexibility, yeah? Because we want a lot of flexibility, but it should be remain manageable. If we all start creating ad hoc variations or extensions, customizations, and or do some copy paste here and there, it's a killer for this, and it will not be manageable anymore, and the cost will go through the roof. So it's really important to be able to manage this. And a way to do that is also through creating abstractions. So the service modeling should be able to support that, so that you can dynamically select different implementations for the same type of functionality. It's also important to have structured reuse. So you use stable APIs or interface modular implementation that really enables you to keep it manageable in the long term. So if we bring this all together, we have your network slice. For example, we want to deliver this network slice. Customer order comes in. Then we have our service orchestrator. That's the vertical automation where we try to deliver this service as fast as possible. So in a fully automated way, this service is delivered end to end across the different domains, the different layers, and within a few minutes it should be available. On the other hand, we also have our CI/CD pipeline for the supply chain automation to really quickly deliver new variations to the market. So create new services or make changes to the network that can, or services that can all go through this pipeline and then also be delivered by the orchestrator in a very short time. So it's really about the interaction between those two is really key in order to get to the results and make it possible to deliver 5G service in a scalable way. Of course, there will be also other components in the picture like monitoring, telemetry, analytics in order to create a closed loop. Because if you want to guarantee certain SLAs, you definitely have to monitor that too. But it's also always coming from the CI/CD pipeline and the orchestrator, because with the orchestrator, you can also configure the telemetry. So for example, if you deploy a new service, that it's automatically monitored correctly, that the right SLAs are verified, and that the AI or analytics knows what to do and how it can trigger the orchestrator to act on that. And the same way, also these configurations can be tested through the CI/CD pipeline. So if you have also variations in monitoring or if you try different AI models, this can also be sent through the pipeline to make sure that you get feedback, early feedback, and before you deploy things in production. So to conclude, end-to-end automation is really critical to make it possible to deliver 5G services in a scalable way, and it requires more than just the automation of service delivery. You also have to automate the entire supply chain from product creation over testing up to deploying in production. And a telco service factory combines, on one hand, service orchestration, on the other hand, supply chain automation in order to really drive the speed of innovation and delivery. This is really the solution to make this possible and make it possible for a mobile operator to monetize 5G. So thank you for your attention. And if you want to know more about this concept of a telco service factory, feel free to download our white paper that we wrote together with Apeldoorn Research. It's available on our website or on the website of Apeldoorn. Thank you.